On with us today is Chairman of Thomas Nelson Publishing, the world's largest Christian publisher, Michael Hyatt. Michael, thanks for being with us today.
Thanks, Mike.
Hey, let me tell you, I have been anticipating this interview for some time. I've loved the book.
Thank you.
All the free stuff that you gave us was fantastic. But, you know, many people don't know exactly who you are. You are you're chairman of Thomas Nelson. You were CEO, president and CEO for a while. So let's just get a little background on you. When you were growing up, was this something that you planned on becoming? Was the chairman of the largest one of the largest publishing firms in the world?
No, I think I wanted to be an astronaut, but there weren't that many opportunities in the astronaut program. So it's a good thing, too, because since they're discontinuing NASA. But no, I got involved in the publishing industry while I was still a student at Baylor University. I took a part-time job at Word Incorporated, which was one of the largest Christian publishers at the time, was later acquired by Thomas Nelson. But I've really spent my entire career in the book publishing field.
You know, you've got some really great books out, and most people don't go into their life thinking that they're going to be writing a book or anything. But, you know, as long as you've been doing this job, what has been the most difficult part about being a publisher and a writer, an author? What makes that job hard for you?
Well, I hate to say this because it sounds like it's just serving the interests of this new book that I've got out, but it's really true. I think it's frustrating when either you create quality content or the authors that you work with feel like they've got something really important to say. But it kind of falls on deaf ears because there's so much competition and so much noise in the marketplace that often it just sinks without a ripple. So I think getting noticed is the single biggest frustration that any content creator has.
You know, like I said, I've loved your book. It's entitled Platform, Get Noticed in a Noisy World. And as a broadcaster, as a podcaster, as a marketer, you know, some of the stuff in here is just like, well, duh. But, you know, there's a lot of people who've been doing the work in media or whatever that don't know these basics. And a lot of things, like you just said, you know, it's not just about the content or the great idea, but it's getting those ideas read or heard or watched. And why is it that it's so difficult now to get our ideas out there?
Well, I think because there's so much noise, Mike. I mean, if you think just last year alone, for example, in 2011, there were over a million new books published just in this country alone. You got 168 million blogs. You've got more video content uploaded to YouTube in the last 60 days than the three major networks produced in the first 60 years of their existence. So, you know, there's apps and social media networks and thousands of radio shows and all of that, but it's just a blizzard of information. And everybody's fighting for something that still, even with all the technological advances, is still limited, and that's people's attention.
You know, I find it so interesting that you use the term platform. So let's just kind of get into the basics of this. What is a platform from your point of view? What are you trying to get people to understand here?
Yeah, a platform is that thing that you stand on to get seen or to be heard. And in the old days, it was just a small hill, maybe a wooden stage, and then in the 20th century, it got a little more complicated because you had to have a radio or a television show, maybe a newspaper or a magazine column or a best-selling book or perhaps even celebrity status. But suddenly, almost overnight, everything changed in about 2006 with the advent of social media because now somebody or everybody basically had a megaphone and they were networked or connected to everybody else. So today, when I use the term platform, I'm really talking about people. It's your contacts, your fans, your followers, your prospects, your customers, but it's the people who share the same passion with you. The thing that you're passionate about, they share it. You're members of the same tribe, so to speak.
You know, it's interesting. It seems like everybody has got something that they want to tell people. You know, whether it be the stay-at-home mom who has got maybe a small at-home business or wants to tell people what's the best way to get a cell phone for their kid or what have you. Everybody's got a message. Does everybody need a platform like this?
Well, I think if you're trying to communicate to more than just a handful of people, the short answer is yes. I mean, it includes some of that you mentioned, public speakers, bloggers, recording artists, politicians, business owners, salespeople, even pastors, but even brand managers in big corporations. And a lot of that's because the kind of marketing that we grew up with just isn't working like it used to work. You know, the kind of interruption-based marketing where you shout loud enough and persistently enough that people just finally cave in to your sales efforts. You know, that's just not working like it used to. It's really about connection and building relationships today.
There's so many great marketing minds out there, and they all seem to be falling into line with what you've discovered here. And, you know, you think of the Seth Godins of the world and the Chris Brogdons of the world, who are all just really just saying, hey, you know, you need something that will launch you into the mind and the eyes and the ears of those that you're trying to reach. But there are other benefits of having a platform. What are some of those benefits that you've discovered that are connected to having a platform?
One of the things I love about having a platform is that it's been a great lab for me. It's a place where I can test ideas, where I can see if my offers are right, and I can see if my content's valuable or if it's resonating with my audience. And the great thing about a platform today is that it's a two-way mechanism. It's a dialogue, not a monologue. So people can talk back to me, and I can get feedback and what we used to call market research, but which was pretty impersonal and pretty statistical. Today, people can talk back in the comments on my blog, for example, and give me real input. I'll tell you a story. When we were putting together the book platform, one of the things the publisher did was, as typical, submitted to me several cover designs. So I ran four of those on my blog, and I used a vehicle called SurveyMonkey.com, and I allowed people to just vote on which one they liked the best and to provide me some input in the comments as to what they did like and how I thought I could improve it. Got huge helpful information that ultimately shaped the final cover on the book.
You know, one of the things I love about your book is that it's short chapters, and somebody that's as busy as I am with an attention span of a gnat, it's so important that, you know, I mean, you've concised all this information. I'd like to just go through some of the things that I found to be so enlightening. And it was the first one for me is starting with wow. And, you know, everybody believes that their product is the best thing ever, or their message or their take on life is the best thing. How do you define what is truly wow?
Great question. Wow for me is that gap, that positive gap that exists between what people expect and what they experience. So, for example, this last weekend, I had to go shopping with my wife for a new car. And, you know, we've resisted and resisted and resisted, and finally it was time. But I dread that experience, you know, going into a car dealership. For me, that's always, you know, a difficult thing. I have very low expectations of what that transaction is going to look like. I know it's going to be kind of miserable. Well, delightfully, I had this great experience with a Nissan salesman because I wanted to buy this electric car, a Leaf. And he was fantastic. He didn't push me. He did what he said he was going to do. He disclosed all the information to me, got back to me when he said he was going to do it. And so I had this experience that exceeded my expectations, and it was truly a wow. So that's really what I'm talking about, is that gap, that positive gap that exists.
Hey, we're speaking with Michael Hyatt. He is a New York Times bestselling author. His brand new book, Platform, Get Noticed in a Noisy World. And another part of this title is a step-by-step guide for anyone. Truly, is this really for anyone?
Yeah, I think it is. Anybody that feels like they've got something important to say, something really magnificent to sell, and they need to connect to more people, and they're finding that the marketing they've employed up until this point doesn't work, yes, a platform is for you. And I'll tell you what, it's longer sustaining than advertising, too, because it's really about having a relationship with a group of people that, again, are passionate about the things that you're passionate about.
You know, one of the things, as I was reading through this book, I got to thinking about my website and my blog and my Facebook account and my Twitter account and my emails and everything that I'm using to reconnect with people after my radio show. And I was like, man, I am so far behind. But the thing is that when I get and sit down in front of a computer and start looking at all the tools that are available to me, I get pretty overwhelmed. Yeah. By the whole thing. Where's a good place to start? If you've never done something like this, let's say we're talking to a stay-at-home mom who wants to reach out to homeschooling moms in her community and wants to set up a platform that they all can get on board together. Where would she start?
Well, the place that I would start, and I talk about this in the third part of the book, but is to build a home base. And this is a place in cyberspace that you own and control, where you've got 100% control of the message and the branding. And for most people, this is going to be a blog. It could be a podcast. It could even be a video channel or a video blog. But for most people, it's going to be a blog. Then you use all the other social media, Facebook, Twitter, Pinterest, you know, whatever the social media of the day is. You use that to refer people back to your home base. And I'm not saying spamming people, but just it's always the reference. You're always trying to bring people back to engage on your home base, because those other social media services, what I call them embassies in the book, are places that you don't own and you don't control, but where you have a presence. So start with your home base.
Yeah, I find that so important, because you make you call into difference that your home base isn't Facebook.
That's right.
Because Facebook, you do not control. You don't control how it's presented or anything like that, but your blog is. And there's a number of places where people can set up a blog for nothing. My first blog was at Blogger, at Blogspot, yep. Blogspot.com. What are some mistakes that everybody seems to be making when setting up their platform?
Well, I think a couple of them, particularly as you talk about a blog, I think one big mistake is that people don't blog consistently enough. You know, when you set out to blog, you're essentially creating a relationship with your reader, and you've got to be dependable. You've got to create wow content, or at least remarkable content, and you've got to be consistent. In fact, that's more important than frequency. And I know many people, when they get started on a blog, they get all amped up, they go out there, you know, they post three times in a row, maybe in 1 week, and then they don't touch it for a month. Well, that kind of breaks the implicit promise with the reader, and they stop paying attention to you. So to just blog consistently, and I'll tell you, everything changed for me in 2008 when I decided I was going to blog three times a week. And the frequency, again, is not the important thing, even if you just did it one time a week, but always blog no matter what. That will build your audience and your traffic and will build your follower base.
You know, that was my big mistake when I first started blogging about 6 years ago, is that I was blogging like after every show. I mean, yeah. Every time I got on the air, I was blogging something. And I realized that first of all, that's really time consuming. I mean, to make it the best blog that you can possibly be, the best article or best post that you can possibly be, that's really time consuming. So I started doing, okay, I'm only going to put on my blog my interviews. Those, in, you know, I don't interview everybody, you know, I make sure that the interviews that I do are the best interviews that not everybody can get anywhere else. And so all my interviews are on my blog. And so when I share portions of my interview, I'm always redirecting them to my blog. All the other stuff, all the quips, all the ideas, all the show prep type of things that I do, I relegate that to my Facebook page. Because only my followers are really interested in that, you know. I develop that way. But then I also make sure that my blog, once I post something on my blog, then it's automatically posted to Facebook, which then is posted to Twitter, so that everybody can see that I've got a new article or a new interview up. What are some other tricks that people can do when they think that, okay, Facebook, Pinterest, Twitter, I got all this stuff going on. I got a blog too, and a website. How do you manage all of that?
Well, it's a great question, and it is a challenge. And realize that almost my entire career, really until a year ago, I was doing all this, building my platform, where I had a very full-time job. I was the CEO of Thomas Nelson for 6 years, and that was a really full-time job. So I had to try to steal away in the morning or steal away in the evening and try to grab an hour a day to do that. But my primary focus was on my blog. I wanted to develop original content there. And then typically the pattern I follow today is that I get up early in the morning. My blog posts at 4 a.m. in the morning so that I catch, you know, everybody on the East Coast and even into across the Atlantic. But regardless, then I go on to the different services like Facebook, and I'll post a link back to that blog post. I do the same thing with Twitter, Pinterest, Google+, etc. But I'm always pointing back. Then one of the things I do is I use an application called Buffer to read through all the news for the day. And if there's something that I think my followers will be interested in, then I load up tweets and Facebook posts in Buffer, again, while I'm reading along, while I'm in the context of doing it. And then throughout the day, it spreads those posts. So I'm really not spending time after that initial burst in the morning, except I'll occasionally just check in on replies and see if anybody has a question.
You know, the... the one thing that everybody is probably thinking about right now is, okay, where do I start? How do I, you know, if I'm a salesperson that needs, that really feels after reading Platform and has been inspired to say, okay, this is what I got to do. I've got, you know, if my sales are going to go up, I've got to reconnect in a different way. Where's the best thing to start? You talked about blogs and developing a blog. What is the next, what's the next best thing to do?
Well, I would suggest, Mike, that people go back to the very beginning of the book and just do a gut check on the wow factor. Make sure that what they've got is remarkable, because great product is the new marketing. And that's true because of what David Ogilvy, the advertising genius of a couple generations ago, said. And that's, great marketing only makes a bad product fail faster. So if you get the cart ahead of the horse and start working on your marketing before your product is really remarkable, you've got failure built into the equation. So go back, make sure that you have a clear differential between your competitors, and make sure the product's right. Then I think the second step is just to step up to the plate and own responsibility, or take responsibility for the outcome. You know, this is not something where you can just, you know, hope that word gets out or delegate it to somebody else or just avoid it. You've got to step into it and say, I've got to build a platform myself. This is my responsibility. And if I don't do it, it's not going to get done. Now, you can employ other people or get even volunteers to help you, but the primary responsibility has got to be on your shoulders.
Yeah, it all kind of goes, like John Maxwell's always said, it all kind of falls back to you as the leader of the pack.
Yes.
Michael, I tell you, we could talk for hours, and I'd have you diagnose my blog and all everything that I do. Mm-hmm. The one thing that I really appreciate about your book is that you give people very short, very simple steps that anybody, truly anybody, can do this. If you were to take on a client, let's say, and somebody would say, I want to get started in all of this, what is the big piece of advice that you would give them right now?
I think the big piece of advice is that they can do this. This is not rocket science. Everything that I advocate in the book, I've done myself. It really does work. And I think we have an unprecedented time because of the technology that's available to us today to get out there and build platforms and to really make a difference in the world, to make a difference for our businesses, for our causes, whatever it is that's important to us. But we've got to take that first step. And don't feel like you've got to get the whole thing figured out from beginning to end before you take that first step. Just be courageous. Take that first step with whatever clarity you have, and you'll figure out the rest. It'll come to you as you need it.
Well, I can't recommend this book enough. And if you have yet to, if you've got a brand new business or you've been in business for a while and you really are in need of great marketing help, Platform is the book to get. I have learned so much about my own personal brand, my personal blog, and I cannot wait to start implementing these steps into what I do on a daily basis. And if I can do it, anybody can. Michael, I just appreciate you so very much, and I thank you for the book, The Platform, Get Noticed in a Noisy World. Hey, you've got a number of websites, a number of ways people can connect with you. Give us that information.
Yeah, the best way to connect with me is at michaelhyatt.com. Everything is there. You can also connect with me on Twitter at Michael Hyatt, all one word, Hyatt. But those are the two principal places that you'll find me.
All right. Michael Hyatt, chairman of Thomas Nelson Publishing and the author of the brand new book, Platform, Get Noticed in a Noisy World. Michael, thanks for being with us.
Thank you, Mike.